spread around the galaxy. Next, we see a young Rey on Jakku, whom had just escaped from her enslavement thanks to her half-droid and friend, Arnold Bot. She was doing her new daily routine of survival. A lot of the Force Awakens stuff, you know, like when we show like the Force Awakens, but picture a 10-year-old girl, whatever she was, 17 or 18. She's younger and she's still going through the whole like rummaging through parts, and we see a scene where she's doing living and you see how she's surviving on the planet. However, she is unaware that she is being followed the whole time by the droid that was left behind by the Knights. The ninja droid, right? And he was there spying the whole time, making sure this is the girl, for sure, that they're looking for. But eventually, however, just as she's about to eat her food, you know, that little food cake that she eats that expands, she's about to eat that, and she notices the droid. She's sitting in the middle of the desert, by the way, doing this. She sees the droid with the corner of her eye. She turns and is about to confront the droid when suddenly a rumble comes from underneath her. A giant tongue comes out from the ground and grabs her on the leg. And then out from the sand, pouring down, you see this giant lizard mole creature. And it's ferocious. And Rey is trying to escape and she's trying to run, but the tongue has her by the leg and it's pulling her into its gaping jaws. And it's trying to pull her in. And Rey is throwing everything she has at the thing and nothing is working. And then suddenly, we see from the back a droid flying in the air. Like Karate Kid styles. And then a blade comes from his hand and cuts the tongue off the creature. Flails back and forth, and then you see the droid then runs and escapes into the dirt from whence it came. Rey is.
You saved me.
Now, cut to a newly formed planet. Meanwhile, on the other side of the galaxy, on the newly formed clone planet, an army of new clones, led by an aging Boba Fett, who is dressed in a gold stormtrooper outfit, but still with his rocket pack, and goes now by the name of Commander Phasma. That's right, guys. So here's what's gonna happen here. Remember the front crawl. These are the old stormtroopers, the ones that were clones, that they were set up with the galaxy and how it was going on and how that was happening and what they were doing, and they felt underappreciated and all that stuff. I'm gonna get into detail about this now. Now remember, guys, in the prequels, we found out that Boba Fett was, in fact, a clone. And we know that. He was a clone from his father, Jango Fett, right? So we know that he's part of the clone. The way he died, I never really liked it. We all know that he died like a pussy. So I always wanted to fix that situation and give him more of a story, right, in this. And so what I have is that secretly, he kind of was a double agent, where he had one hand, he worked as a bounty hunter on the side, but was actually heading up his own personal clone army that he was trying to create an uprising, right? And he does this, right, with the help of the Hutts and the Faleen, right, who help fund him, and because they don't like the Empire either, and they figure if they can get on the ground level of this uprising, they could be a powerful force too, right? And the way he escaped from the Hutts' palace, right, remember, that was way too easy of an escape for them, I always found. And to remedy this, I felt that what they should have done was have Boba Fett actually working secretly, allowing Luke and them to escape by being bumbling. Like, he was bumbling like a weird fool out there, and he kind of allowed people to think that he died, you know, like a clumsy elf, when really he was just trying to go fly out of the radar and then go to form his rebellion after that. He was trying to, not just a coup on the Empire, but they were also trying to overthrow the Hutts, right? And that's why he helped them, not helped them, but he allowed them, through his buffoonery, allowed them to kill Jabba, making the Suns being able to take over their enterprise. It was in bed with Boba Fett, and Boba now leading the tribe. So now we're in the future, guys, remember that. And Boba Fett now is leading the group of clones. He is the general. His mask is gonna be still the same mask, though. He's gonna still have the same mask. So picture that mask in a stormtrooper outfit with the rocket pack, but gold. Maybe you could put some red and green trim on it just for nostalgic purposes. And so now he's standing on the podium in a stadium sort of thing. I love Force Awakens, that sort of a scene, right, where he's talking to all his troops, trying to get them to rally the troops. Standing beside him is a little girl, a female clone. The first female clone, like the weird sort of anomaly that happened, and a female is wearing a silver Star Trooper outfit, and we all know who she's gonna be, right? When Boba Fett gets older and he eventually goes by the wayside, or it gets too old, that little girl becomes Captain Phasma. Now Captain Phasma, everybody, has an actual relevancy to the story. She is no longer being, oh, she's going to be like the Bumba Fett of the universe. She literally is going to be the clone, but an anomalous female clone of Boba Fett. So there we go. A little backstory there, guys. Back to the story. He is accompanied by a young girl who is his daughter. They are assembling an army that they believe is ready to take on the Republic. He now delivers a speech rallying his troops. We have waited long enough. The time for us to strike is now. While they're busy putting together another bureaucratic meeting and a proposal, we will strike them hard when they least expect it. Huzzah! Huzzah! What the clones are after here is they're tired of the old Jedis, and they're tired of the old religion. They want a conquest in the name of science, in the name of technology. They've actually developed a giant space cruiser that has the ability to mimic, actually, the troops themselves, the major generals that work for them, also have like certain technologies that can to dampen the force using sonic waves. Or it's basically, if someone wants to use the force against them, you know, they'll use the force, then they'll, you know, they'll have like some sonic waves going, and then it'll scramble the brain of the Jedi trying to use it, like, oh, that kind of thing. But the ships can also mimic certain powers of the force, which is force push. Don't ask how it's being done. There's some technology there that we don't know yet. It's probably going to be some, like, sucking the life essence of some force user or something. But it's going to be horrific, whatever they do. But it's going to be on a ship, and they're going to be able to force push. You know, they can force push planets into other planets. They can force push. They can just force push buildings to crumble. It's just this giant force pushing technology that they developed, and it's aboard their battleship cruiser. So that's their major weapon. So we are ready to strike now. Huzzah! We see all their ships rising to the sky and are about to take off for Coruscant. That's their number one target right now, is Coruscant. Now we cut back to Rey, who then befriends the droid. The droid then tells Rey that he has been sent there by her father to rescue her.
I was sent here by her father.
Rey says,
"You know my father? I don't remember my father. I was here on the noggin. I don't remember my parents."
The ninja droid then tells the young Rey,
"Your father was a very powerful force user. He is now trying to rebuild the old Jedi religion and bring balance back to the force."
The young Rey is intrigued. For some reason she couldn't understand, she did not believe the story the droid was telling her. Just some innate instinct within her was skeptical. Not enough to make a decision, as she's still naive and still listened to him. However, there was just some alarm bells being run in her mind. Suddenly, just as he finished saying his words, dust cloud appears blowing, and the ship lands close to where they were parked sitting. Out from the door opens for the ship, Luke Skywalker, the two droids, and Ben walk outside the ship. Rey looks outside, mystified, at the man walking from this ship. The droid now beside her is unnerved, and he starts to back away. Rey then turns to the droid.
"What's going on? What's wrong?"
The droid then turns and starts to run, and as the droid runs away, he goes under the communicator and says,
"Luke Skywalker has called for the girl. Send the knights."
Rey, confused at what's going on, looks,
"Where are you running to? What's going on? Who is this?"
Luke then calmly walks over to the girl, puts his arm over her shoulder, and says, "I'm Luke Skywalker. Heard of me?"
"Luke Skywalker? You mean THE Luke Skywalker?"
"That's me."
"For some reason, I thought you'd be taller."
He chuckles. She asks,
"Were you sent here by my father too?"
"No. I'm here because I sense a great destiny in you."
"That's the sort of weird stuff that droid was saying."
Luke then looks at the fleeing droid, and just as he starts getting suspicious of the droid, another ship lands, blowing towards Luke, right beside Luke's vessel. And the door then opens on this vessel, and the three Knights of Ren in formation come, in the Mighty Ducks formation, come out of the belly of the ship, each brandishing lightsabers. One of them brandishing Kylo Ren's lightsaber. Luke then turns on his lightsaber too. "Back away, Rey. He tells Ben and Rey, get behind me. Then the lead knight says,
Luke Skywalker, I presume.
That's me.
You will hand over the girl now.
Now we cut back to Coruscant. And Leia is fiddling on her desk with some papers. All of a sudden she senses a feeling of impending danger.
Han!
What?
And your Han comes running in. I'm sensing something. Ben and Luke are in great danger. You must find them.
All right.
Not even thinking, not even saying anything, Han just takes off.
Come on, Chewie, let's go.
So they run and they get on an elevator to the top roof of the penthouse where they see better than ever. It's been all modified, a version of the Millennium Falcon. And so they,
come on, Chewie, let's go.
Takes off and heads in hyperspace to meet up with Luke and Ben. We cut back to Luke and three knights engaging in an epic lightsaber battle. Luke has now taken on three of the knights all by himself.
Very whole.
Now he's in an epic lightsaber battle with the three. Luke does eventually beat one because he caught right through the shoulder, cutting one of the arms off the knight on the left side. The lightsaber then tumbles to the ground and rolls to where Ben Solo was standing. Ben then looks at the lightsaber and feeling a draw to it. And remember, this is this lightsaber right here. The medieval sword lightsaber, and he looks at it longingly. As he turns it on though, it burns a little as it splashes with fire. And he sees it in his room. Luke is still engaged in a battle with Rey behind him. Great freaking lightsaber scene you've ever seen in your life. Ben from behind and strikes one of the knights right on the back. The knight caught wind of it just in the nick of time, so it did not kill him, but it wounded him very badly. The knight then turned and looked at Ben Solo holding the lightsaber menacingly and said,
How interesting. I sense great power in you, boy.
And then using the force, knocks Ben out to the ground, knocking him unconscious, grabbing Ben, and then runs immediately to the ship. Luke, still engaged in battle against the leader of the knights, sees the injured knight limping towards his ship with Ben Solo on his shoulder. Luke then leaps over and cuts him off just as he's about to enter his ship. Where do you think you're going? And he force pushes the knight to the ground, falling with an unconscious Ben on top of him. Rey then runs to Ben's side and starts to shield him. She's protecting him. She then picks up the lightsaber and is like,
stay away from him!
Then Luke, just as he's about to strike the injured knight, Luke gets struck from behind. Luke then still standing in front of the open doorway of the knight's ship, however, sensing the danger, managed to not take the full brunt of the force and immediately just sliced him a little bit, making just a mere flesh wound. Luke then turns and sees, standing in the doorway, another 10-year-old girl. This girl is dressed all in black, and she's brandishing a red lightsaber. Luke senses something familiar and dark within this girl. The girl is also wearing sort of a ninja mask. You can't really see who she looks like, but you can tell that it is a girl, as her hair is pinned in a ponytail, and she's got warrior face paint. Luke immediately thought, you're a Sith, in his mind. The 9-year-old girl then pulls the lightsaber without hesitation, and frantically, with ferocity, striking Luke. Luke, defending. Luke could easily take the girl out, but because it's a girl, Luke is hesitant. Now, the lead knight then gets up and runs towards Luke, and now he's in the bathroom too. Now we cut back to Han Solo and Chewbacca aboard the Millennium Falcon.
Don't worry, Chewie, we're gonna get there. I'm worried about them too.
And then, what the hell is this? On their sensors, they sense the Clone Army Armada heading towards Coruscant.
I'm getting a bad feeling about this, Chewie.
Han then, with the Millennium Falcon, hides and parks the Millennium Falcon in a nearby asteroid field as he watches the armada of ships heading towards Coruscant pass by. This is trouble. He then radios for Leia.
Leia, prepare the ship. You're gonna have company very soon.
Tells them about the invasion that's approaching. croissant goes up in an alarm, and ships rays from the ground. Leia's now...
Everyone to the ships! There is an invasion approaching!
And you see the Republic also fly up from Coruscant into space to head off the invading clone army before they arrive. Now we cut back to Luke, engaging in battle with the two knights and the Sith girl. He is now backing up, and he's starting to tire. He's now in a posture of defense. One of the knights is already without an arm and is bleeding to death. He's pretty much out of the fight, limping, and he gets up. Force pulls Rey toward him, takes the lightsaber, grabs her by the arm, and then pulls Ben over his shoulder and starts limping back towards the ship. Luke, still engaged in the battle with the two knights, with the knight and the Sith, sees this in the distance. Force pulls Rey out of the arms of the injured knight and tries to force pull Ben, but he does no longer have the strength. And just as the knight is about to enter, with Ben over his shoulders about to enter the ship, we see blaster fire from the sky. And the ship explodes, blasting both Ben and the knight onto the ground. Ben hits the ground hard again. The knight is pretty much incapacitated. Then we see the Millennium Falcon exit from the clouds. Luke then says, I owe you one. The Millennium Falcon goes as it's about to land. Luke, distracted by the explosion, he did not notice that the Sith girl and the lead knight had already taken the unconscious Ben and were headed now to Luke's ship. Luke, they have taken Sir Ben. Luke tries desperately to prevent it, but they had already entered the ship and it was too late. Where's Ben? Han Solo says as he's running with his blaster out, ready to fire, and Chewbacca at his side. He's on the ship, they're escaping, Luke says. Han Solo instantly shoot at the ship. The ship is rising. Luke, without every ounce of strength he has, tries to hold the ship in midair with his force, but he's filled with cuts and injured, and he's bleeding from the injury he sustained on his back. But he doesn't have the strength, and he collapses. The ship then takes off. Gotta get him! Han, Chewie, Luke, and the droids go run quickly to the Millennium Falcon. Falcon tries to pursue the fleeing ship, but when they get there, the ship had already gone into hyperspace, and they lost Ben! Luke, feeling upset and despondent. They did manage to save Rey, turns to his friend and says, don't worry, Han, I'll promise you I'll get Ben back. I know you will. But right now, we have more pressing matters. There's an invasion headed toward Coruscant. The Millennium Falcon takes off. Full speed back to Coruscant, where you see the battle is already taking place. It's a huge battle, and that force weapon is really doing a number. The Republic forces is just instantly just destroying ships around, and simultaneously force pushing buildings to the ground. An amazing space battle. You're seeing the destruction of Coruscant, the buildings collapsing and pushed over, people screaming on the streets. All you see are just ships flying. Commander Phasma Fett, he's actually not on the bridge of the main ship. He and his daughter are actually engaged in the fight because that's where he feels. He's still on Slave One. He's a leader, but he's a hands-on leader the way Darth Vader was. And he's fighting along with his forces. Luke and Han get there just in time. Luke hops on his familiar ship that you see, and he got R2. This looks familiar, doesn't it, R2? He's now the Red Leader. And he takes off. When Falcon's already engaged. Luke tries to use his force to knock down the thing, but it doesn't work. Ben's trying to tell him something. The Force, Luke. Remember the Force. And then he's like, Ben. He gets cut off from Ben because the Force weapon they have is disorienting him. Take the flagship! So the Millennium Falcon, this new weaponry is also doing really good. It doesn't need a guy on the gunner anymore. Do that. You don't need Chewie to be on the gunner to do that. It actually has an automatic systems to do that now because it's the future and they fixed it all up. Eventually though, they find the hole or some form of weakness in the ship that they discovered over time. With a lot of casualties, they managed to blow up the clone flagship, defeating the clone army. Sensing that this is it, that the fight is over, Boba Fett, now Commander Phasma, then tells his troops,
we've given them a bloody nose to think about. We will now do a strategic retreat, but we have made our presence known.
And the ships then turn around and escape. Coruscant is safe for now. This has sustained a lot of damage, a lot of lives lost. So the next scene is the ship's lying down. Luke is coming out of the cockpit of the ship. Leia greets him and greets Han. You see a sad scene with Han and Leia hugging each other. Luke behind him going, I promise I will find Ben. And Rey is beside Luke the whole time. He looks at Rey and goes, you're gonna have to come with me first. Rey gets on the ship with Luke and the droids and they head off, leaving a waving Han and Leia behind them. But with a somber look. We cut to Rey and Luke in space. space now with the droids.
Where are you taking me?
I'm gonna take you where I was trained. The ship now lands in a familiar swamp, Dagobah, where they see the ghost of Yoda.
Took long you have.
There's been a lot of trouble.
Yes, sensed it I have.
Ghost Yoda has already started the school and he's already training a few young Jedi there. And Luke, together with Ben Kenobi, were there. So we got the Ghost Ben and Ghost Yoda helping Luke train. Rey, this was one of my Jedi masters. His name is Yoda.
A little bit small to be a Jedi master.
Judge me by my size, you do?
You know, and he just like lifts something to prove something to her. Hope she's not too old to start the training.
Old she is not, but training she will do. Mary Sue, she will not be.
Luke then says, I made Han and Leia a promise if I have to find Ben. So he and R2-D2 and C-3PO, they get on the ship and they take off. And once in a while, he periodically comes in to check up on Rey and to see how she's doing. So now, cut to the final scene. And it's aboard one of the three Star Destroyers from the first scene. And we see Snoke holding Ben by the hand. To the side of Snoke is the 10-year-old Sith girl, and he tells Ben,
the Emperor has been waiting for you.
The door then opens. You see a familiar throne room with the glass beside it, silhouetting a man in a dark robe. The black robe man then turns around, lifts his head, and then Snoke says,
brother, I failed to bring Rey. However, I brought you someone almost as important.
He lifts up his head and says,
Ben Solo, I presume. Or should I say, Skywalker?
The door then closes. Guys, that's the show. Now, before I end this, I want to say this, that final scene, somebody asked for the Emperor to be returned, but the Emperor was supposed to be Bill Cosby, so I didn't want to spoil the show. I thought it would be an impactful ending
to actually have it be the Emperor.
But we're going to redo that with an alternate ending. So somebody requested this, guys, so remember, this is my story. Someone in the comments requested this, so I'm doing this. So, it opens up and he says,
Ben Solo! Or should I say, Skywalker? You see?
And then, someone requested Bill Cosby to be the Emperor. So, you gotta keep my promise and make him even for just half a second. Guys, if you're asking how the Emperor is still alive, so this is how it is. The Emperor's lightsaber was discovered. And what we find out about the crystals within the lightsaber is that they can house a soul. They can actually house a piece of the soul from a Jedi. And what they didn't know is that the Emperor already had embedded his part of his soul from years and years of holding this lightsaber, and his soul is actually attached to the lightsaber. So when they discovered somebody discovered the Emperor's lightsaber just before the destruction, and it ended up possessing this person, and his face kind of slowly turned, kind of like the Exorcist, back
into that old feeble man.
Alright guys, that's the first installment, guys. That's episode 7, Rebooted. Now, again, for those people who I didn't include their contributions, don't worry, I plan on doing part 2, and hopefully I can do part 3. I haven't decided yet if I'm gonna do part 3. I am definitely gonna do reboot part 8. So, don't worry about that one. I'm gonna reboot that one. I got a lot of plans for that. And hope you enjoyed this. And so guys, just so you know, I will be taking some more ideas for people, if you guys, so you know what the story is. So now, if you guys want to contribute further and send in some more ideas, I'd be open to hearing some more ideas, as long as it follows the story that I already told. And like I said, if I didn't get to your contribution already from people who did send something, trust me, I am going to get to it in the future. Because I had to save some for other movies, right? I didn't want to blow the load on just the first one. So don't worry, I am going to get to your ideas too. And don't worry, I will eventually get to part 2 if you guys really enjoyed this. Let me know in the comments, you know, if you have any other advice and what you think I could do different or better. If you guys want to do some artwork for this, that'd be awesome. I might even do a re-edit where I include some of your artwork. That would be awesome too. And if you could, like, even for the next sequel, if you want to do some art for this and help me out, I will give you obviously a shout out, and I will include it in my next reboot. Alright guys, thank you for watching. Till next time.